making sure that he was always pulling up in a limo. The reason I say that is that's exactly what's happening here with Absalom. He's just making himself look really important. Now, I remind you, he was the fallen, guilty son of a king who fled by on his own, but his dad pulled him back into things, but not with any repentance. And so what is he doing? The first thing is he wants to make sure you know he's important. That can happen in the church simply by somebody demanding that they have a title. When somebody says, are you the pastor? I would tell you, I'm not the pastor here. I'm a pastor. There are genuinely guys in here that in some cases are doing a better job pastoring certain groups than I am. Praise the Lord for that. I don't want to be the pastor. If there's one great shepherd, it's never going to be me. That's Jesus. And if you stop at me, you've stopped short. I mean, I am, in the sense, a pub burger compared to the great five guys that the Lord, I mean, it's a really sorry example, but for some of us, that really means something, you know, that it's like this, you know, what is this compared to this amazing thing? And the reason I say is it's just, at best, it's a sorry substitute, but it is not the same thing. But this guy is really starting, and what he is doing is, and understand, he's going to refocus, and then he's going to recruit, and then in essence, he's going to ship off. He's going to then deploy. He's going to refocus, and then he's going to recruit, and then he's going to deploy. And that's his whole methodology. How does he get people to refocus? He uses two tools. You know what the two tools are? Ego and entitlement. Because that's what worked with him, and because he knows it works with him, he knows it'll work with you. So he shows himself important, and if he shows himself important, then you know what happens next. People are going to want to be near him. Have you ever heard about those guys on the YouTube that actually went and hired a bunch of bodyguards and did the same thing and then ran into a crowd with a bunch of bodyguards around them and all that, and everyone was asking for their autographs? Because people didn't even know. I'm like, oh, I love you. And they're like, oh, yeah, what movies have you seen? Oh, I've seen all your movies. Of course, they've done none. But it's like, oh, can I just have your autograph? Can I get a picture? And everyone's selfieing with these guys because they've hired themselves out, in essence. Because people want to be around important people. Why do we want to be around important people? Because somehow we don't feel we are. And if we don't feel like we're important in the eyes of God, we're definitely going to play this fool. And if you cannot get justified at the cross and realize how important you are there, where God would actually rather die than live without you, there is no place in the universe that you're going to feel validated. So he sets himself up to live large. And it tells us then, it happened that Absalom provided himself chariots and horses to run before him. That will definitely take and refocus you. He takes the spotlight. He puts himself in the middle of the who's who. Because if he's there to recruit, he must first have your focus. Now Absalom, verse 2, would rise early and stand beside the way of the gate. This is him now recruiting. Remember, by this point, everyone knows who he is. Oh, you're the guy with the entourage. You're the guy that looks like you just stepped out of a rap video. What is that? That's an entourage. It's like, you know what you are? You're a guy that actually just glued a bunch of pieces of fake gold to the front of your teeth, and you rented a car. And you got a bunch of girls who would never have sat next to you, but since you're paying them, they're going to put on their bikinis and stand out in the cold for whatever their pay is for. They're not trying to be mean or cynical. The whole point is, it's amazing how people will buy it. If you don't believe that, all you have to do is watch any sporting event and watch the cartoons. Actually, it's pretty close. The commercials that happen. Because you know what? It's like some sort of, you know, overweight, middle-aged kind of guy that's sort of sitting on a couch and he's there all by himself watching. But he cracks open whatever the pub lager is or the beer or whatever the thing is. And then like bikini-clad gals pop out of the telly. Now, we all recognize that's nonsense. But there's something in the back of their heads that go, some guy, because they assume that a lot of guys go, oh, that's kind of me. I don't, yeah, except I'm younger and better looking. But they're sitting there watching it. Just the same, and if I get this beer, girls are going to jump out of my telly. Well, that tells you that the idea is, man, I just want that. I remember when they interviewed MTV back in its heyday, and they said, we don't influence the youth, we own them. You ask a lot of people today in the media that are actually in the media, they'll tell you, we don't actually report the news, we dictate it. And the reason I say that is, it's easy to recruit when you've made yourself important and people believe it. Do you remember Oasis, the band? Do you know when they became real popular? It was when they started telling everyone they were the best band that has ever been since the Beatles. But they lived it and they genuinely acted like they believed it. But the problem is you have two guys that sooner or later are going to believe that they're that great, and you can't put two guys like that in the same room for long, like Absalom and his sons. So this is how Absalom starts to recruit. First, he starts to show himself as the important guy. And then it says, so it was. He stood at the gate early. Whenever anyone who had a lawsuit came to the king for a decision. Now understand, initially that every tribe had leaders in their tribe. And if they couldn't get that worked out, they would actually go to a priest. But if they couldn't even get it worked out with a priest, the final say was the king. So in essence, they were this sort of, you know, David was in essence the Supreme Court. They were the law magistrates. They were the top of the crown court. And so in all of that, these people are in essence queuing up. Whoever had a lawsuit would come to the king for a decision, and Absalom would call to him and say, listen, he'd say, hey, what city are you from? And he would say, wherever, and then he'd say, oh, your servant's from such and such a tribe of Israel. And Absalom would say to him, look, your case is good, and it's right. But there is no deputy of the king to hear you. Notice what he starts with. Hey, where are you from? That's important. I want you to know you're important to me. Oh, well, tell me about your case. Oh, that is an important case. Wow, look how important you are. And then you know where that goes? It goes from that to criticizing. From that to making it sound like, because he's going to play on your sense of fairness. He's like, wow, how long you been waiting here to get this court trial? Days? I mean, one king, how many trials can he see in the course of a day? Well, how long you been waiting? That is a really long time to wait for justice. But I remind you, Absalom was not waiting for justice. Absalom became his own justice. He became, think about it, isn't that kind of what happened? He became a vigilante. Instead of waiting for God to step in and pronounce proper judgment, he just decided to take matters. He was tired of waiting for this thing to come out right, so he was going to make it happen himself. So he understands that, and he's pitching that to everyone else. Do you see how important you are? And if you see how important you are, then aren't you entitled to a better trial, a quicker trial, a speedier trial? Aren't you entitled to get your justice? Aren't you entitled to get this to happen? Don't you realize that? Do you realize how this destroys marriages? Do you realize how this destroys friendships? Do you realize how this destroys churches? Because what you have is you're like, don't you realize how important you are? Why don't they recognize how important you are? That is so unfair. And they come up with two basic things. Isn't the king aloof? Isn't he he should be more involved in your life. I bet he doesn't even know your name. He has no clue where you're from. I do. Look at how important that is. Look at how important you are. And clearly the king doesn't. The king doesn't care. That's the other thing. He obviously is uninvolved and he doesn't care. And that's the same thing the enemy is going to say to you. It's like that trial you're going through, that struggle you're having problems with, that challenge that stares you in the face, that sin that you still can't seem to get past, that area that seems like it's so on top of you, it's like a mountain and you're getting crushed, and the enemy goes, you know, God's not even watching. He doesn't care. You know, if God really cared, he'd clearly step in by now. You better take matters into your own hands, don't you think? But that's not what he's saying. He's saying, he does that, and then he goes, oh, look at verse 4. Oh, that I were made judge in the land. Oh, then everyone who has a suit or a cause could come to me and I would give him justice. So don't you see how unfair this is right now? Has anyone ever come up to you and told you how they got the raw end of the deal, but they were the guilty party? Has there ever been anyone? Have you ever been that person yourself? Well, you knew that you were the sinner, or at least party to the sin, but somehow in party to the sin, you don't want to think about that. Somehow you just feel like it's just not fair. Well, what are you entitled to as a guilty party? We live in a world, let's face it, where often the victim is more victimized as the actual perpetrator who actually gets all kinds of rights. Now, I'm not trying to just criticize. The bottom line is that as Christians, we have to trust the Lord is going to make this thing work out. I trust in God's sovereignty. I mean, when someone stole from you in the Old Testament and they were ultimately caught, they had to restore fourfold for what they took. Fivefold if it was your ox. In other words, if they stole stuff from your house, it would have been fourfold. If it was your car, they had to restore fivefold. The best thing that could have happened to you was someone stole from you. You'd be like, wow, really sorry that you took my clunker, but now I'm getting myself a Jeep. Now, the reason I say that is that in the end of it all, the guy who did wrong had to make restitution, and the victim was actually compensated. I mean, that's the way it's supposed to be in a perfect world anyways. But what he's doing is he's playing into this, don't you think this is unfair? So unfair the way I'm being treated or the way you're being treated. Because the way that they recruit is to play into your ego and then they play into your entitlement. You are entitled to more than this. I happen to know a better place. Oh, that better place, by the way, is, oh yeah, it's me. I will be the one that'll help you here. I mean, can you believe the leadership and what they're doing? Clearly the leadership's a bunch of bozos. I mean, you know, and I remind you, this is his dad he's talking about, the one who extended his heart and restoration here. And when he extended that restoration, what was clear is Absalom had no interest on taking his terms, but it looked like he did. He stuck his face down in front of everyone so that everyone could say, well, poor Absalom, he really tried to make it right. But what's clear is he's not. And the way you see it is, he's recruiting. So as you do, as he recruits, and that's what we see here, he gets them to refocus on him, then he recruits, and then he deploys. It says then, verse 5, so it was, whenever anyone who came down to bow to him, that he would put out his hand. Now, remind you, he's made himself to be very important, that he would take him, it says here, take him and kiss him. Do you realize what that says? It's, oh my goodness, this royal really cares about me. Imagine, and by the way, I'm only saying this is hypothetical. I am in no way inferring this is true because I don't believe it to be. But imagine, if you will, that Will and Kate really wanted to take the throne for themselves. So what they did is they started making public appearances where they're like, you know what? Let me hear you. Oh, it's such a shame you're really not getting real justice. You don't care. And then they were like taking selfies with everyone and inviting you over to dinner and they're giving you big hugs. And you're like, check it out. Here I am hanging out with Will and Kate. How cool is that? I mean, you could see how easy that would be for them to start swaying the hearts of people. Well, that's what Absalom's doing. And the reason is they're clearly very high profile and they're clearly royals. So here's a guy, and he's like, you know, you're offering him your hand to handshake in essence, and he's like, brothers don't shake hands, brothers got a hug, and they're just, come here, you know. And it's clear here that though we seemed, and you know what the crazy part is, at a moment like this, could you imagine the conversation we would have about him? What an amazing person. You know, I mean, he's caring, and he's gentle, and he cares about people, he cares about us. Look at the time he spends with us. They have no idea that he's recruiting. And to be honest, sometimes people recruit, I don't even think they recognize what they're doing. Well, I'm not telling you don't care. I'm telling you that we never do it at the expense of our king. That's the point. So it says, in this manner, verse 6, Absalom acted toward all Israel, came to the king for judgment. So Absalom stole the hearts of the men of Israel. Now, you are aware of the fact that to steal means you are taking something that doesn't belong to you. It is not rightfully yours. And Absalom, those hearts of those people do not legally, if you will, belong to Absalom, but Absalom has taken them himself. And I go, he's come to steal. Does that sound like anyone else in Scripture? In John 10:10, Jesus tells us the enemy comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But the good news is Jesus doesn't end there. He says, but I have come that you would have life and life more abundant. So listen. Ultimately, what he's done is he's refocused, he's recruited, and he's deployed. It says then in verse 7, it came to pass after 40 years that Absalom said to the king, please let me go to Hebron to pay a vow which I made to the Lord. By the way, it's interesting how many times in such a rebellion, such a mutiny that you bring the Lord in as if somehow he's actually part of it when he really isn't. For your servant took a vow while I was at Geshur in Syria, saying, if the Lord indeed brings me back to Jerusalem, then I'll serve the Lord. Well, this is the weirdest way to serve the Lord I've ever seen. And so the king said to him, go in peace. So he arose and went to Hebron. Then Absalom sent spies throughout all the tribes of Israel. I remind you, there's all these people who've been planted now all over talking about how amazing Absalom is. And they said, as soon as you hear the sound of the trumpet, then you shall say, Absalom reigns in Hebron. In other words, what you're saying is, David is no longer my king. This is my king. He has sent spies around everywhere to say, listen, from this point on, when you hear the trumpet, you say, I pledge allegiance to the new king. That's what you're saying. And Absalom went 200 men invited from Jerusalem, and they went along innocently. They didn't know anything. So there are people, by the way, who will get caught up in this whole thing completely innocently, and then they're going to be stuck. Then Absalom sent for Ahithophel, the Gilonite. Now, that was David's counselor, but it was also Bathsheba's grandfather from the city of Gilo. While he offered sacrifices and the conspiracy grew strong, for the people with Absalom continually increased in number. Last couple verses, it says, now a messenger came to David then and said, the hearts of the men of Israel are with Absalom. And David knows what that means. What that means is his own son wants to kill him and take his throne. That's what it means. Imagine a son of the king wanting the king dead. That sounds like an interesting story. 1,000 years later, we'll see something like that when they say that the children of the kingdom would, by the way, is what the religious leadership in Jesus' day would call themselves. So David said to all of his servants who were with him at Jerusalem, arise, let us flee, or we shall not escape from Absalom. Remember, he's still his son's dad, or his dad, he's still his dad's son. Which means he's got to be somewhere in all. There's a fighter in him. Make haste to depart, lest he overtake us suddenly and bring disaster upon us and strike the city with the edge of the sword. David's like, we are in no position right now to fight this kid. And how could you imagine having a child and then actually having to deal with the emotional aspect of what do I do at this moment? And David, interestingly enough, at this moment, his first thought is, I don't want you guys getting hurt in this family business. I need to get you all out of this thing. We need to get out of here because he's going to attack this city and he doesn't care about you guys. The reason he does is because he knows it hurts me. And let me say this, beloved, you got to hear this with your heart. Please, please, please hear this with your heart. The only reason that you are in any way on the enemy's radar, the only reason why you have any importance to the enemy is that he knows something better than you do. And what the enemy knows better than you do is he knows how much God loves you. And he knows how much God loves you so much that he knows that the best way to hurt God is to hurt you. He knows that better than you do. He knows that my Father cannot stop thinking about you. He knows that my Father is infatuatedly, completely, and obsessed in love with you. And he knows that the only way to really hurt him is not to go after God himself. He knows he doesn't stand a chance, but if he could go after you, and the best way to do it is to get you to hurt you, because if you can hurt you, then who does God use? How does God step into that? And the enemy knows that God loves you that much. And if we knew that God loves us that much as he knows that, we would recognize how stupid it is to follow the enemy. Now, in a situation like this, what's clear is the enemy still uses those tools today. And what he does is he gets you making it all about you. And then he makes you feel like you're completely entitled to things. And the moment you feel like you're entitled, then God's not fair. God's not fair enough. He's not involved enough. God is not early enough. God's not timely enough or punctual enough. Clearly in all of that, because you've decided how God's supposed to act. I've decided how God's supposed to act. And the moment I decide that, then God doesn't fit into my character. I'm angry at God, the one who created me, redeemed me, saved me, and sent his son to die on the cross for me. How insane is that? But at that moment, I feel like it makes perfect sense. And then in that, I start going, man, that king. And whether we know it or not, our hearts stand up and start pledging allegiance to his enemy. How horrible is that? But let me tell you the good news is that tonight our eyes have been opened and challenged. And we can go and call it church and still make it all about us. We can talk about how you're going to be the blessed one and you are the chosen one and you are, and then we'll go into entitlement. You are entitled to your blessings and you just tack in Jesus' name at the end of it all and that bill is paid. And you can just expect the car and expect the house in Chelsea and expect your football team to win every game from this point forward. So start playing down your bets. You know, it's amazing how you can go to places and they're called churches and it still does the same thing that Absalom is playing here. And in the end of it all, when it doesn't, when all of a sudden that cold doesn't go away when the oil's on your head, and when all of a sudden the marriage doesn't get healed instantly, that sin still becomes a challenge for a period of time. We become angry with God, and then they start telling you about how we have to forgive God. Could you imagine that? Forgive God of what? He does no wrong. But you need to recognize. You're like, God, you said that you're only going to give me good things, but we've dictated to God what a good thing is. Could cancer ever be a good thing? I would say yes. Because in God's eyes, the most important thing is your relationship with him. And if that's what it takes to get you right with him, he would do it. But I've learned this. If God can steer you with a feather, he will not use a sledge. Because he doesn't have to. If God can move you with a whisper, he doesn't have to shout. But I warn you, if God has to shout, it's never pretty. My God never uses excessive force. So when my God throws me to the mat and tells me that I have to stay in bed for something, I'm like, wow, am I that thick that I haven't been listening? And I'll be honest, the answer is, yes, I am. I am a doofus. But here's the good news. My God loves me. And the only reason he's doing it is so that I could be completely right with him. And the same with you. But I will never be right with him if I'm full of myself and then I feel like I'm entitled to just dictate what God should give me. Because there's no humility and there's no surrender. There's no vehement desire, no clearing of myself, no indignation towards my sin. At best, I have a sorrow that is a worldly sorrow, and that leads to death. And that's the best case scenario. But my God took all of my sin, and he put it on his son, and he died on a cross for me so that I could be made right with him. And if that was what he was willing to do for me, and someone says, your God doesn't care. They have no clue. And if when I was still a sinner, Christ died for me, when I was still his enemy, he died for me, when I was still in my own heart driven by the prince of the power of the air, and he died for me then you can't tell me that my God doesn't know timing. My God is never late, but I've also learned he's never early. But Jesus even said to his brothers, for you, any time is right. But he had a time. To Mary and Martha, my brother's dying, come. And it says, because Jesus loved them, he waited. He waited. Why didn't he just do it then? Because he wanted to do it at a time when it was clear that only he could do it. And we tell God, God, you have to do it by this, whatever that is. And we told him, because if it doesn't happen by then, it is done, it's dead. And God goes, death doesn't intimidate me. I can raise that. Don't tell me about a deadline. Keep your eyes on me and listen. I know what I'm doing. So tonight as we go to prayer, let me just ask you. And I'm asking me as I'm listening to this. How much Absalom is alive in me right now? Where I'm still making it about me. And I start looking around and start telling you I'm entitled. To what? I'll tell you what I'm entitled to. I'm entitled to hell. I've properly earned that.
But I want to thank the Lord that he's not giving me that. I do find it interesting that Absalom did not recruit from the enemy land. He didn't go up to Geshur to get his army. He actually took from the king's camp. Don't you find that interesting? And you don't want to do that here. But tonight, what if we laid down the Absalom in each of us? We said, God, destroy, overcome, claim total victory, conquer the part that wants to stand against you, the part that's in rebellion to you, the part that fights your lordship. It says, hey, I'm happy to have you serve me, but this king thing I'm having a problem with. Well, Jesus doesn't say, if you just confess me as Savior, we're good. But that we confess him as Lord. And that's fundamental. So tonight as we pray, and will you pray with me in this, that God would do exactly that. Conquer the Absalom in us. Pray with me, would you please? God, I confess to you that Absaloms dwell and thrive in each of us if we're not careful. And I just speak for myself to say that, man, when something happens and it just seems so unfair, I tend to take my eyes off of you and trust that you really are sovereign and you know what you're doing. And I know you do inherently. But sometimes I tend to focus more on me at a moment like that. And I feel pain. And when I feel pain, I want to see that pain rectified. And I recognize my mind is way too small to understand eternal justice, to understand how you can actually make sure that this, that all sin is punished and yet still bring sinners to repentance, to still see them restored. But I recognize, for me to demand you to do things on my terms, there is no repentance at all there. It is in essence me recruiting you into my camp. And I recognize as a pastor, you call us to do something similar. To not, well, we seek to refocus too, but in a way, Lord, where what we seek to do is really to draw people to you, not to us, but to you. To engage you, to others, to you, to engage them through the cross, to engage them through the gift, Father, of your Son that paid for all of our sin and rose again. And as we seek to engage them to you, then we seek to equip them, not to recruit them for our purposes, but to equip them so that we can enroll them to your will, not to ours. Because it just isn't about us. It's about you. And you are so brilliant. I'm not going to even for a moment pretend that I understand your ways. But rather, I trust your character, your heart. I know, even when there are billions of things happening around me that I don't understand, I know that you are good and that you are brilliant and that you are the Almighty. And that's all I need to know. Because in that, I know that because you are Almighty, I know that there is nothing too hard for you. And because I know that you are good, I know that you will do what is necessary. And because I know that you are brilliant, the most brilliant, I know you'll know when to do it and how to do it. So instead of me figuring you out, I want to walk by faith. And I just want to give a moment in silence to every one of us for those people that we know that have harmed us or have injured us or in some way have offended us to where we felt like it wasn't fair. Tonight, God, in this room, deliver us from becoming an Absalom to that situation right now. So Lord, as you put people's names or faces in our hearts and minds, Lord, we want to lay them back down to you and say, God, take these things from us now so that we could walk out of here as humble servants, Lord. So for a moment here, even in the middle of this prayer, as we get quiet, if the Lord bring anyone to your mind that you feel you've been treated unfairly by or that they've recruited you into their unfairness, lay that down before the Lord right now and let God cleanse you from that. Let's do that right now. Forgive us for the anger and bitterness, God, in places we don't understand. When we recognize that we are being forgiven of infinitely more in our own lives in the ways that we have gone against you. We release these things to you now. These people, these situations. Some, they may be continual and chronic pain. Some there may be really deep hurt. But you who forgave the world and live inside of us as Christians can forgive through us. So we pray you cleanse us of that bitterness and that anger and that resentment, because we recognize those are all things that look like Absalom. And we don't want to look remotely like him. So get our attention off ourselves and these individuals who make us think of ourselves and the pain we feel, and get them on you and cleanse us now. Purge from our souls these pains, these regrets, these angers, these injustices that we cling to, and fill that vacancy with faith. And a peace that comes from knowing that vengeance is yours. And that you are good, the most good, the most brilliant, and almighty. Jesus, we confess that you died on the sin for all of our nastiness. And you taught us to forgive others, even as we forgive those who trespass against us. So, make us those who genuinely forgive those who trespass against us, not just trespass against you. And tonight, make us people who before you are not setting boundaries and standards that as if we have a right to you, but rather in humility we lay our lives down before you as our King. And we just humbly ask, make us healthy in you, in our hearts and spirits and minds. Make us healthy in you, that we would be the people you call us to be. Free us from any Absalom within us or any influence from Absaloms in us, as we're yours. In Jesus' name, amen.